When conservatives suggest that public schools are indoctrinating children with Islam, the left is quick to dismiss the claim as some right-wing conspiracy. But is it true? Are public schools indoctrinating children with Islam?
Good morning. 6:44. Parents are set to meet with school leaders this week about a controversial homework assignment they say is forcing their children to learn details about Islam. The parents in Walton County want their district to make the lessons optional.
Well, Sharon, Micah, these parents tell me that they have no trouble with their son learning the history about any religion. It's when the school starts teaching him the faith.
Well, Florida parents are showing their frustration over a high school textbook that dedicates an entire chapter to Islam. They're protesting outside this school in Volusia, claiming that Christianity and Judaism aren't getting the same treatment.
There is an agenda of elevation and eradication.
Elevation of Islam and eradication of all other religions through the lessons in a social studies textbook.
This is an attempt to Islamize public schools, and the board members of this are falling for it based on identity politics and for other reasons.
The sixth grade history class in Grosbeck is studying Southwest Asia this week. Students were sent home with homework last night. This one focused on the religion of Islam. When one girl's parent noticed that one of the pages asked questions that show how one can attain salvation through Islam, they were stunned.
But we wanted to know who actually picks the curriculum, who picks the videos that they were shown, who picks the 20-page PowerPoint, who decides what gets included and what doesn't.
And you can't get an answer. I can promise you this without knowing any details, but I'd bet you lunch that interest groups are involved.
And I can recommend that you would get involved in the following facets of school systems. One is the social studies book adoption committees, the social studies curriculum advisory committees, the human relations committee, the gifted and talented programs, the minority achievement programs, the literature committees, and the superintendent's advisory committees. I think that if we do all these things, we can have a permanent effect.
Talk about this assignment that came from a different teacher in a different school system.
This is a high school in Wisconsin, and the students were asked to pretend that they were Muslim, male or female in the United States. Within this five-paragraph assignment, they have to give three examples of what you do daily for your religion and any struggles that you face. Again, the reminder was five paragraphs, intro, three paragraphs in the body, and a closing. And keep in mind that they were apparently watching documentaries that would back up the facts that they could use to support this essay. Well, some people were concerned, hey, did you do this for other religions? Mm-hmm. And what does this have in the role of a history class?
Yeah, 10th grade world history class.
Sure. A couple of years ago, the same high school fell under critique, by the way, for passing out a crossword puzzle to students that defined conservatism as, quote, the political belief of preserving traditional moral values by restricting personal freedoms.
Oh, yeah, that is certainly the textbook definition of conservatism. One of the parents said that she felt that the purpose of this was to show prejudice toward Muslims in America or to invent or exaggerate them. The big question is, I wonder if any of the kids who took that assignment and said, pretend you are a Muslim, actually wrote down, for instance, what Sharia law is. You know, and what is involved in that? And if they did, I wonder what their grades were. I know that an organization, an educational watchdog group out in that area, asked for some answers. They have not responded to the questions, but they're good ones.
Essay assignment available for other religions as well to be explored in this classroom.
In the UK, they are now writing letters to terrorists.
Aww.
Being taught to respect terrorists is a new teaching aid. So they actually wrote about this from express.co.uk. I hate that they have to have those URLs. A new teaching aid that recommends school children as young as 7 write a letter to a terrorist to help understand their motives has been condemned as dangerous and misguided. Really?
You think?
The book in question is called Talking About Terrorism, Responding to Children's Questions. Now, it tells primary age children that terrorists kill people because they believe that they are mistreated or unfairly or not shown respect. So they want to teach kids to sit, as opposed to like writing letters to Santa, you're writing letters to the serial rapist.
Yeah.
In the mountains of Syria.
Well, Muslim students at a public school are now officially allowed to refuse to shake hands with women. The controversial policy at Hurstville Boys Campus has been backed by the Education Department. It's based on an Islamic tradition, but many are asking why Australian values are being ignored.
The Education Department is backing the school's policy, but they flatly refuse to answer any questions about how many schools have policies based on Islamic hadith and whether or not they support religion informing policy in our secular schools.
Some Manhattan Beach Middle School parents feel the school has crossed the line.
This is
it's illegal, basically. Mm-hmm. You can't teach religion in schools anymore, but apparently that, in this particular school at least, that's not the case.
They say they recently discovered their son's homework assignments on Islam were more about actually learning the faith than the history. One question asked him to write down teachings from the Quran.
What I saw written in these bubbles was the one true God, Allah, in one of the bubbles, and one of the other bubbles was all people must submit to Allah in another bubble. Now I turn the page over and I see the five pillars of Islam.
One of the five pillars he had to learn.
Shahada is the testimony of a faithful Muslim that Allah is the one true God.
It shouldn't be presented to them. They shouldn't be asked to know this.
They say the students should be taught the history behind religions, be it Judaism, Buddhism, Christianity, etc., just not the actual faith.
Can you imagine the outcry all over this country if children were bringing home paperwork that asked them to write down John 3:16 or ask them to write down the Ten Commandments?
And if it ended with the declaration of faith, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. That's what the equivalent.
History books, social studies books, world cultures books. I am involved in a 1.5-year project as part of the Muslim Education Council to look at every single sentence that exists in all the books nationwide about Muslims, Islam, the Arab world, even the pictures that are presented, to pull those things out, look at them, see what's wrong, rewrite what's wrong about them, and then have those checked by scholars, and then submit that to the book companies and ask them to change it.
A group of parents in southern Indiana expressed alarm because their children in a local middle school are learning that Sharia law is delightful and loved by women. The school assignment provides a fictional account of a young Muslim girl expressing how much she loves Sharia and feels very fortunate to be governed by Sharia law. The fictional Muslim girl also loves being some guy's second wife. In South Carolina, sixth graders learned the five pillars of Islam and were asked to fill in blanks about Islam and match up statements from the Quran with the five pillars of the religion. One of the indoctrination worksheets reads, "Islam is a religion of peace, and that I feel bad that a few people of my religion committed terrorist acts." A California mother rips her 7th grade son's worksheet after he's taught the five pillars of Islam class as well. Students were required to list the five pillars of Islam and scan a QR code with a mobile phone or tablet, which would take them to a YouTube video of a call to prayer at the Blue Mosque in Istanbul. Parents in Georgia also found that their students would have to recite the five pillars of Islam as well. School assignments in the UK follow this indoctrination model as a father found his 12-year-old daughter's school plan and was shocked to find that she was forced to write a letter about converting to Islam. In Massachusetts, a high school assignment had kids simulate an Islamic pilgrimage to Mecca. The classroom, like all the others that focus on indoctrinating our youth with Islam, has textbooks with slanted texts written by Muslim apologists, and the textbooks are filled with opinion pieces written by left-leaning, non-scholarly publications like Time Magazine and The Guardian, and videos that collaborate with advocates of the boycotting Israel movement. One handout given to students stated that all Muslim scholars agree on the fact that the first greatest jihad is the personal spirited struggle towards discipline, a blatantly false statement. Also in Massachusetts, the College of Art and Design hosted an event for children to make Valentine's Day cards against Islamophobia. Most of the children who attended the event were under 10 years old. In addition to having children make cards, the sponsors of the event encouraged parents to make donations to the Muslim Justice League, among other organizations, to help people fight against Trump's executive order on immigration. But of course, the school denied the event was a fundraiser, but a GoFundMe page benefiting the Muslim Justice League explicitly touts it as one because these people lie. Florida parents are upset about a school textbook that inaccurately portrays Islam to make it more acceptable. Like all these textbooks that push false Islam, they conceal information about honor killings, genital mutilation, stoning of women accused of adultery, and treatment of women as property, omitting that Muslim women can only have one husband while the man can have four wives and women need their husband's consent to divorce.
One particular religion, in this case Islam, has an entire chapter of 35 pages devoted to it in the world history book, and although Christianity and Judaism and other religions are also mentioned, they're in little snippets throughout the entire book, and I'm simply asking that all religions be equally represented to the youth in this world history book. There's context in here as far as discussions of Sharia law and how peaceful Sharia law is, and again, I just want factual information to be in the context of this book. If we had the five pillars, in this book, there's a five pillars of Islam in the book. Could you imagine if we had a chapter of Christianity, 35 pages, and the Ten Commandments, and an assignment at school that has students read biblical scriptures and report their findings in a one-page report, there'd be a tremendous outrage. However, I don't want an indoctrination, so to speak, of an entire chapter of one particular religion over the other. So,
other Muslim apologists pushed back. One student used herself as an example that Islam is great to women by citing all the things she does in America, and then by asking, does that sound like I practice a religion that oppresses women? In Maryland, a lawsuit is moving forward when a girl was forced to profess and write out the Islamic creed in a Maryland school. The creed, known as the Shahada, is a profession of faith to Allah and considered by Muslims to be sufficient to convert a person to Islam. Forcing the girl to disparage her Christian faith and acknowledge Muhammad as her spiritual leader, the teen was required to memorize and recite the five pillars of Islam. The girl's history class spent one day on Christianity and 2 weeks immersed in Islam. Such discriminatory treatment of Christianity is clearly a promotion of one religion over the other. Richard Thompson of the Thomas More Law Center said the course also taught false statements such as Allah is the same God worshipped by Christians and Islam is a religion of peace. The girl's father, a former Marine, contacted the school to voice his objections and to obtain an alternative assignment for his daughter. The school not only refused but forced their daughter to either violate her faith by pledging to Allah or receiving zeros for the assignments. The girl and her family decided not to complete the assignment anyway. Then, in an effort to silence all pro-Christian speech in her school, the school principal, without a hearing or any other opportunity to refute the false allegations against the father, issued a no trespass notice against the girl's father. In Virginia, during a world geography lesson, a teacher had students also complete an assignment that involved writing out the Shahada.
Virginia, 2015. Students are given a take-home assignment in their geography course that instructs them to copy this phrase. Its meaning? There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Now, after a sensible backlash from the community, the assignment was pulled and the school district involved apologized for. They said the assignment wasn't intended to be religious indoctrination, and that its purpose was just to demonstrate how difficult it is to write words in Arabic. Now, if the purpose of the assignment was just to demonstrate how difficult Arabic is in its written form, why not use literally any other phrase except for an affirmation of Islamic faith? I mean, honestly, this is a public school that we're talking about. Just imagine if that same school assigned one phrase for kids to copy over and over again in Latin, and that phrase happened to be an affirmation of Christian faith. How fast would the lawsuits be filed by the ACLU? Yet the left strangely has no problem teaching kids how to affirm Islamic faith. In fact, when secular and deeply religious parents questioned the assignment, they were labeled by the media as Islamophobic. Unfortunately, this is not an isolated incident.
While these professions of faith in Islam are happening in the schools, simultaneously a University of Washington professor was investigated and put under probation for mentioning God in class. She was accused of being discriminatory and racist and was sent to a re-education session because a Muslim student asked the teacher what she was going to do when she retired, and the teacher replied, "When I retire, I want to share the word of God with people." The Muslim student complained, saying that the statement made her feel unsafe. The university was more than happy to comply.
Education is one of the most important areas that Muslims have to address. And while our objective, our final objective, is not just to become part of the system that we experience now and that we see, our objective, our final objective, is to create our own Islamic systems, and not only create Islamic systems for Muslims, but to look at all the other people who are sharing this country with us as potential Muslims. And in that long-range process of making America Muslim, all of America Muslim, then we have to have some actual short-range goals. We have to have some way of dealing with them and know how we're going to deal with them and in which ways, and be very calculated about it, or else we will not accomplish our goals.
The students are asked to watch all these videos funded by the Department of Education. In one of the videos, they are shown how to conduct a Muslim prayer, how to wash before praying, how to lay out a prayer rug. Why do children need to do this? This is a Sunday school class. This is what the Department of Education has put out for teachers to incorporate into their classroom.
Got it. So last question. I mean, the mark of objective coverage is skepticism. Is there any skepticism in evidence of Islam? Is there any criticism of Islam's role in, I don't know, the slave trade or any historical event? Is there a critical distance from the topic, or is it just presented as something neutral or positive?
No, it's definitely presented as positive. When children watch a video of a man that converted from Christianity to Islam, that's promoting Islam. When that same man looks those children in the eye and say, "Submit yourself to Allah because Allah is the one true God," and this is funded by the Department of Education for school use, this is no longer something that's comp- pairing religions.
No.
This is violating the U.S. Constitution.
Yeah, that's propaganda for sure. And not surprising. Again, diversity.
In Tennessee, students will continue to be indoctrinated with teaching about Islam despite parents' objections. Parents from across Tennessee expressed alarm because their children in a public middle school are learning also about the five pillars of Islam in a world history class and also required to profess their faith to Islam, writing the Shahada. The teacher also encouraged students to wear hijabs, or they can use scarves and wear them as if they were a hijab. At the same time, the parents say the course material ignores Christianity. Since at no point do Tennessee middle school students study Christianity per se, there is not, for example, one class day dedicated to the basic Jesus story. Other Tennessee middle school students were given a school project to create the five pillars. One parent whose child was forced to write out the Shahada said this is a 7th grade state standard and will be on the TCAP. Christianity was completely skipped and is not a standard. I didn't have a problem with the history of Islam being taught, but to go as far as to make the child write the Shahada is unacceptable. Since there was backlash at their previous Islamic indoctrination attempt, a new plan has been put into the curriculum, not to remove the deliberate Islamic indoctrination, but to better conceal it. In the new standards, there will be a name change, changing the course from Islamic World 400 to 1500 to Southwest Asia and North Africa 400 to 1500 CE. Some references to the Islamic world have been changed to Africa. In other words, they are hiding the teaching of Islam under new headings like Asia and Africa, areas of the world that were conquered by Islamic Jihad and terror. A father of a girl at a German school discovered that his daughter has been forced to learn the Islamic prayer when he discovered a handout that she had been given. Another German school forces children to visit a mosque. At first, some parents stopped their 13-year-old son from going to the geography field trip. The parents claimed to be worried their son could become indoctrinated. The father reportedly argued that nobody should be forced to enter a place of worship against their will, a perfectly reasonable claim. However, the school's principal said no exceptions could be made to Germany's mandatory education laws, but after the parents still refused, the government ordered the children to visit the mosque or face a fine of up to £270. But it's not just Germany. British authorities are also prosecuting parents for not allowing their children to visit a mosque during school trips.
If you stop your child going on a school trip to a mosque, you're an Islamophobe, and maybe you need to be investigated for your thought crime. They were putting racial discrimination notes against a child's educational record if they didn't go on a, quote, religious trip. And it was, of course, always a trip to a mosque. Well, now a council in Britain is taking action to crack down on Islamophobia, which is not a real thing and doesn't exist, in response to some parents refusing to send their children on mosque visits arranged by schools. Now, there's been a lot of backlash over this. We've seen pictures out of the Netherlands, other countries, where they're made to kneel down, in some cases, made to recite the conversion prayer to Islam. Oh, it's just a school trip, don't worry about it. The local council reacted by producing a document claiming mosque visits are vital in preparing children for life in diverse Britain. Again, this is another part of the capitulation. Not multiculturalism, it's you capitulate to that culture. Of course, if Muslim parents withdrew their kids from visits to Christian churches or Christian assemblies, would that be characterized as Christianophobic? No, it wouldn't. It would be completely allowed. There would be no consequences whatsoever. But no, you have to bathe your child in this new tolerance and diversity. You don't get a say. The state controls your activity. And if you kick up a fuss, well, maybe you need to be investigated for your hate crimes. Absolutely insidious.
This also isn't unique to Europe. Texas Christian University also forced students to visit a mosque and do so on Good Friday. If they don't comply, it'll cost them 10% of their grade. Although TCU is a private school, a private Christian university forcing students to attend a mosque on a Christian holiday should serve as an indication that forcible visits to mosques are not only coming to America, they are already here. In a Dutch city, parents were outraged that school children were taught the Muslim prayers after a video emerged showing children learning how to pray at a mosque. New Jersey schools are under the same as Islamic indoctrination plot.
Well, parents in Chatham, New Jersey are disturbed by what they say is a local school's inordinate emphasis on teaching the beliefs of Islam while at the same time suppressing any expression of Christianity. Students in a Chatham Middle School social studies class were shown a cartoon video describing the five pillars of Islam, the religion's core practices. The video included such statements as, quote, there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is his messenger, and it ends with a non-Muslim accompanying a Muslim friend to a mosque to pray. Well, parents Libby Hilton Rather and Nancy Gayer say the video doesn't just explain Islam, it promotes it. Libby, describe, if you would, why you think this instruction crosses the line from simply teaching about a religion to promoting it.
You're teaching the tenets or the doctrines of a religion. So our question was, okay, then if you're going to do that in the public school, would you also be comfortable teaching the doctrines of Christianity, for example?
Well, sure. Yeah.
To say, would you be comfortable in a public school to say, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to him, but comes to God but through me. And
right.
I don't know that the school would say that.
I mean, Libby, I've seen stories like this before, and they follow a pretty familiar course. Parent sees something like this, parent complains, parent gets denounced as Islamophobe or racist. Has that happened to you, either of you?
Oh, both of us, to a great extent. We were labeled as bigots immediately following the Board of Ed meeting in an op-ed.
Textbooks in New Jersey schools write the Crusades have had a lasting effect on Muslims and that Christians' harsh treatment of Muslims continues today, despite the Crusades being a late and small-scale defensive action after 450 years of Islamic jihad conquered over half the Christian world. But the myth that the Crusades were an unprovoked aggression against a wholly innocent Muslim world persists and has even made its way into public school textbooks. Texas parents are also upset over Islamic indoctrination of their child in a public school.
It's just they've taken God and other things out of the schools, and but yet they're going to push this in there secretly.
Another Texas school had been allowing Muslims to leave school for hours at a time to attend a mosque every Friday afternoon with no repercussions, and then reward them with taxpayer-funded mini mosque in school.
The trademark of what makes Liberty High so great is our diversity and how our students respond to the different cultures and diversity on campus. You know, we have other religious student groups that meet maybe before school, maybe an after school, and as long as it's student-led, where the students are organizing and running it, we pretty much from a school stay out of that and allow them their freedom to practice their religion.
Also, in Texas, Muslim apologists are outraged at a councilman who thinks indoctrinating children with Islam is bad and calling for it to be removed from the school curriculum. The Texas city of Plano even accepted a recall petition for the councilman to try and remove him. But Texas isn't alone. A school district in New York will set aside rooms in which its Muslim students can pray during the month of Ramadan. Another Canadian school converted a computer lab into a mosque and banning all non-Muslims from praying there.
She was stopped outside the computer lab. They couldn't get to the computer lab. And the reason was that prayer was going on inside the computer lab. And they had to wait for half hour before the prayer was over and they could get into the computer lab.
So the computer lab was turned into a mini mosque, if you will.
It has now become a mini mosque kind of the situation.
And other students who are not Muslims were prevented from using the computers.
Yes. So there was a clear description in the studies that we can show.
Despite the blatant prioritization of Islam and suppression of any other religion, there are groups like this one, the National Coalition Against Censorship, that fight for Islam under the guise of free speech, calling campaigns to end Islamic indoctrination as undisguised Islamophobia, who misrepresent teaching about religion as indoctrination into religion, and that they misunderstand the imperatives of the First Amendment and threaten the integrity of the public school system, citing a clause in the First Amendment that prohibits government favoring or disfavoring any particular religion, but doesn't prohibit teaching about religion when presented objectively as part of secular education. But this is an important point that the left will try to push. When conservatives say that schools are indoctrinating children with Islam, they don't necessarily mean the schools are literally trying to convert them. While there is some aspect of that happening in the schools, that's not the main point. The criticism is that schools are teaching a fake Islam, a version of Islam that doesn't actually exist. But this is important because Muslim apologists will use this straw man argument and push back by denying that they are trying to convert kids to Islam, which is not the main argument. Ironically, this so-called free speech group, which cites the First Amendment, actually highlights their own false position. It is precisely because the teachings are not equal, secular, or even honest that it is unconstitutional. Along with teaching a whitewashed, fake Islam, there is an unfathomable bias and blatant hypocrisy happening in schools, as they provide privileges and protections for Muslims never given to any other religions. It has become so overbearing that the San Diego Unified School District teamed up with CARE, a radical terrorist affiliate group discovered in the Holy Land Foundation trial, who partnered with the school district to devise and enforce an unconstitutional anti-Islamophobia bullying program. As part of this program, Muslim students get special protections and additional access to resources, while students of other faiths are excluded.
When the board passed a proposal to prevent bullying of Muslim students.
I just can't understand why people would think protecting children would be a controversial issue.
This policy favors one religion, Islam, over all others.
I think to show preferential attention to any group does not...
basically equal protection under the law is what we're guaranteed. And that's not equal protection. That's elevating one group above others. I think bullying should end no matter who's bullied. And I don't care what their religion, their color, their creed, or their national origin. So to single out Muslim students is obviously not a proper thing to do. Are you not going to protect a kid that's not a Muslim? Are you going to give preferential safe places to Muslim students? Right. What about other people? So let's stop bullying, but let's not pick on those groups that are not bullied enough.
I was shocked to learn that this agenda, which blatantly promotes Islam, was passed under the guise of an anti-bullying policy. Right. Don't get me wrong, I'm completely against this discrimination bullying of all kids, including Muslims. But anti-bullying, anti-discrimination, and anti-bigotry should apply equally to and be enforced for all students. Right. If bullying is really what you're concerned about here, then that's what you could that's what you should be focused on without giving preferential treatment to Muslims or promoting Islamic religion and culture in public schools. What makes this curriculum even more ridiculous is that Islamic ideology and Sharia law discriminate against Jews, Christians, homosexuals, women, and anyone who opposes their ideology. Islamic ideology and Sharia law are incompatible with the U.S. Constitution and free speech, and promoting them actually undermines our nation. I'm almost done. I just want to say, not only is promoting Islam under the guise of an anti-bullying policy unconstitutional, but it's hypocritical, it's a waste of resources, and I strongly urge you to rescind this discriminatory policy.
If you're going to teach Islam in the schools, I just want to make sure that you teach the true Islam.
Have your name, please. I'm sorry.
Roger Ogden.
Thank you.
And not a falsified Islam that has been approved by CARE. And Muslims teach that Muhammad is the perfect moral example for Muslims to follow, like Christians follow Christ and Buddhists follow Buddha. But the problem is that Muhammad was not a moral person. He beheaded hundreds of people because they did not accept Islam. He waged aggressive war against non-Muslims. He used terror tactics against non-Muslims. He raided caravans to pay for his wars. He engaged in sex slavery. He married a woman after he had beheaded her husband. And he had sex with children. He married a six-year-old girl and has sex with her when she's nine. And this is in the Muslim literature. And these board members are the bullies.
Okay. Thank you.
According to the San Diego District's numbers, it has a total student population of 130,000. And out of those last year, there have been 7 reported instances of religious-based bullying, and it doesn't specify which religion it was that singled out. There's no explicable reason to reach out to a specific religious community for such a thing, and it's unconstitutional. It violates the Establishment Clause guaranteeing not reaching out to any specific religions.
In Minnesota, children were to sing Arabic songs, including Allahu Akbar, during a holiday concert. By holiday concert, I mean Christian and Jewish holidays, which now make room for Islam to be more inclusive. In Italy, children will be banned from singing Silent Night to make sure not to offend Muslims. At Marquette, a Catholic school will pay for faculty members to attend an Islamophobia conference, which will teach them firsthand how to censor people who talk honestly about Islam. UCLA also hosted a Muslim American workshop where attendees proposed a list of policy suggestions intending to help Muslim Americans. Suggestions included banning anti-Sharia laws and to eliminate First Amendment protections against hate speech. College Republican receives threats after asking a Muslim Student Association to condemn the Barcelona terrorism, which of course they refused to do. In the end, the College Republican was attacked for his bigotry for asking Muslim groups to condemn terrorism. But the promotion of Islam and suppression of anything and everything that is opposed to Sharia is embedded within the curriculum at every level. And even more frightening, it's only gaining support. Young people today are often so ignorant of Islam they can't even call out terrorism, and their historical ignorance has some side effects. The National Union of Students even refused to condemn ISIS because of Islamophobia, saying that condemnation of ISIS appears to have become a justification for war and blatant Islamophobia. Harvard students go on record about their beliefs that Donald Trump is more dangerous than ISIS. At Ohio State, students hold a moment of silence for the Ohio State terrorist attack, who was killed not because of attacking nearly a dozen students with a knife, but because of police brutality. A Columbia student op-ed lectures us that terrorist attacks are our fault because terrorist attacks happen because of Islamophobia, hate, and oppression of Muslims. And Islamophobia needs to play a critical role in explaining these attacks, and by recognizing the hate that helped facilitate tragic events like the Brussels attack, we can unite and prevent such attacks from happening again to ensure an inclusive community. Which doesn't explain why jihads have been happening for 1,000 years, but the voice of historical ignorance is loud and quick to throw Islamophobia on the table. But where do students learn such nonsense? Well, there's a couple sources. One is the curriculum, two is the actual educators. The Toronto School System Guidebook, which is a guidebook for teachers, will include the Muslim greeting alongside O Canada and invite children to visit a local mosque. The guidebook has an alarming definition of Islamophobia, defining it as fear, prejudice, hatred, or dislike at Islam or Muslims, or towards Islamic politics or culture. Some parents were concerned over the definition because it could lead to teachers who display dislike towards murdering gays or abuse of women and terrorists to be cited as Islamophobic, which is the point. The Muslim Brigade works diligently to have broad definitions so they can mold them to fit whatever they choose them to mean. The guidebook also glosses over anything controversial about Islam to paint Muslims in the best possible light. Another teacher handbook in the UK justifies jihad violence when committed by those who believe themselves to be victims while attempting to align Islam with secular Western principles in incoherent stance. The co-author of the handbook also has a jihadist pedigree and is openly against measures to stop terrorism, and does so because, quote, the demand could fuel anti-Muslim sentiments in British society, which means the UK shouldn't try to stop terrorism because the suggestion might cause Islamophobia. The co-author of the teacher handbook also serves on the Muslim Council of Britain, which is a group that consistently opposes programs to stop terrorism along with a wealth of terrorist allegiances. For example, the MCB's former leader attended a memorial service for the founder of Hamas, a terrorist group, but the teacher's handbook does give some specifics of what makes terrorism okay. When Muslims have been wronged, as a last resort for trying to solve a dispute, to preserve Islam or protect the oppressed. Also within the teacher handbook, there is an Islam in the media section which says, many Muslims feel they are targets of a sinister agenda and that there is a commitment on the part of big news and corporations to demonize them, which proves conclusively that there is an institutional prejudice against Islam, and it is important to redress the imbalance of constant negativity about Islam and Muslims in the media. This is what UK schools are using to guide teachers that are supposed to be teaching children. But it's not just the curriculum, it's teachers as well. Another school teacher advocated Muslims to take up jihad and establish a global caliphate. At DePaul, a private Catholic school, is also home to an ISIS-supporting professor who supported the 9/11 terrorist attacks and advocates re-establishing the Islamic State. George Washington University hired a so-called reformed Islamic terrorist as Homeland Security expert, and shortly after the hire, the reformed terrorist was arrested for cocaine and trying to hook up with a prostitute. At Kent State, a professor was actually caught trying to recruit students to ISIS. Another school teacher in New Jersey asked students to compare the actions of anti-slavery John Brown at Harper's Ferry to the actions of Osama bin Laden in September 11, and after not having her contract renewed, she's suing New Jersey for discrimination. Another professor at Ohio State educated us all on how it wasn't Islam that was responsible for the Orlando nightclub shooting, it was toxic masculinity. Another professor at Cal State Los Angeles named Muhammad reaffirmed his belief that genocide is not always immoral and sometimes even morally required. A Harvard professor excuses ISIS sex slavery and terrorism because the U.S. had slavery 150 years ago. A Rutgers professor posted her thoughts on America on social media, saying that America is more brutal than ISIS. Another professor at Florida Atlantic, who speaks at a seminar about Islamophobia, just so happens to have a long list of terrorist connections, including when he was working at the University of South Florida, he co-authored publications with another USF professor, who was sentenced to 57 months in prison for providing aid to Islamic terrorist groups. The two professors were so tight that the current Florida Atlantic professor used the terrorist professor as a reference on his application. At Northwestern University, a scholar there discusses how Christian fundamentalism is more dangerous than Islamic terrorism. Let that one sink in. Another professor at American University teaches the outright lie that right-wing terrorism is a greater threat than Islamic terrorism. While I won't go at length about that particular lie here, because I have another video that is focused completely on debunking the lie that right-wing terrorism is greater than Islamic terrorism, so if you want to learn more about that, a link to that video is in the description. Another professor at Yale teaches teaches students that Christianity and Islam are fundamentally the same. A North Carolina professor does his part teaching young people that 9/11 was America's fault and we should sympathize with terrorists. The English class he taught at several universities focuses almost entirely on writings from the perspective of Islamic terrorists. The syllabus includes books and poems that portray terrorists as freedom fighters driven by oppressive U.S. foreign policies. The professor blasts America's depiction of 9/11 terrorists as monsters to justify squashing them in a fantasy of justice in order to justify more imperial violence. The College Republican stated that these readings offer points of view that justify terrorism, paint the U.S. and its government as wholly evil and immoral, and desecrate the memory of the victims of 9/11. But these professors are not isolated incidents. Presenting terrorists in a sympathetic light and that the U.S. is an imperialist nation is standard operating procedure. This is what, in varying degrees, most college kids are learning today all over the country. The university, of course, supports the professor, citing the importance of diversity of viewpoints. Except for conservative ones, they like diversity of viewpoints so much that a University of Cincinnati music professor was fired for responding to Muslim students' anti-American posts with several facts about Islam and Muslim women. He wrote, "The U.S. president's first sworn duty is to protect America from enemies, and the greatest threat to our freedom is not the president, it is radical Islam. Review this list of Islamic terrorist attacks and then tell me about your hurt feelings. Muslim females are safer in America than in any other Middle Eastern country. How dare you complain while enjoying our protection?" All of this is true, but still unacceptable, as the teacher was forced into retirement, but professors who support terrorism are A-OK. A Florida teacher posts on Twitter that imams worldwide instruct Muslims to invade Western countries, outbreed them, and overthrow governments and kill infidels and implement Sharia law, which is exactly what they do.
What he said to me was that our civil liberties and our openness and our willingness to be responsive to other people's cultures were actually gifts from his God, that they were weaknesses and flaws that they had put, that he had put into his God, Allah, had put into the American culture so that we could be defeated. He said that the easiest way to do that, in spite of the fact that Al-Qaeda dreamed of these big, huge, catastrophic attacks, that wasn't particularly practical. That the easiest way to win the long battle to take over the world with Sharia law was actually through immigration and by outbreeding non-Muslims. He said that like-minded jihadi brothers would immigrate to Western democracies and to the United States. They would wrap themselves in our civil liberties for protection. They would support themselves in our welfare systems while they spread their jihadi message. And then, when the time was right, they would rise up and attack and actually ratchet up the acceptance of Sharia law by making it frightening for people to push back against their efforts to impose it. Here's the way political correctness works for a guy like Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. It allows them to operate in our midst without being challenged. It allows them to ratchet up the focus on Sharia law without us pushing back on it. And we end up inadvertently imposing on ourselves the blasphemy laws of Sharia because we cut back on the things that they find offensive. We change the way we dress. We don't have Christmas parties anymore. You know, we don't say Merry Christmas to each other on the street. You know, women have to wear headgear. They set up these enclaves, and out of these enclaves, they try to impose Sharia on those people who come into them. We simply have to not let that happen.
But even so, this teacher has been branded as an Islamophobe and racist, despite being black and repeating things that Muslims admit. Meanwhile, a Toronto school teacher calls a jihadist who crushed the skull of a 4-year-old girl a hero and martyr. An Australian school principal was replaced after a long list of indoctrination attempts, including pressuring students to attend daily prayer meetings, lectures on the Quran, and even cut their hair. But that's not all. He was fired for refusing to participate in a government program to counter violent extremism after the school was deemed high risk. The principal said he was not comfortable having prayer groups being stigmatized. Unsurprisingly, the principal is a Muslim, and parents have spoken out saying the school was run more like a mosque than a school. And there are multiple claims of students being assaulted and teachers threatened to be beheaded. And the principal who replaced him is receiving threats from those peaceful Muslims. So it's not hard to understand why even teachers across Europe are complaining that mass Muslim migration is making education impossible. Sweden is predicting a massive teacher shortage because nobody wants to teach all these Muslim students who can do whatever they want. The Islamic indoctrination is layered on so thick that teachers are actually scared to teach about 9/11 because doing so might make them an Islamophobe. Worried teachers are flagging terror 3 times a day after staff report radicalization in the playground and weak school policy towards extremist behavior. Parents must be ever vigilant to the Islamic indoctrination of their children under the guise of teaching history and multiculturalism. This is happening in public schools all across the country.
However, they tell half-truths about Islam spreading peacefully.
If they're going to teach about Islam, I'd like to see them speak the truth instead of a whitewashed version of Islam as a peaceful religion and coexisting with our U.S. Constitution and with the Christian philosophy. It will not, it does not exist. That is a complete lie.